Hi there, I'm Will Sentance, CEO and co-founder of Codesmith, a software engineering school in Los Angeles and in New York and online. And today we're going to cover in this course some of the most important aspects of the language. We're going to go deep into higher order functions, into closure, into asynchronous JavaScript, the event loop, the callback queue, the microtask queue, and then finally wrap up with a deep dive into the prototype chain and into classes. These are concepts we use a lot in JavaScript, in Node and in React, understand them truly, and we're far more equipped to problem solve as engineers. So thank you for joining us in this course, and I look forward to seeing you on the inside. For running multiply by two before we're able to move on to any further code, we're going to create a brand new execution context. Here it is. I'm going to draw the big box. Look at this. This is what it is. We, by the way, have seen one already. This was the big one. This is called the global one. This is the one that as soon as we start running our file of code, we create what's called a global execution context for running the overall file of code. Like, think of it as the main program. As soon as we start running a little function, a little mini bit of code, we create a mini program, a mini execution context. Here it is. I've made this very big. There it is. And it has, as I say, two parts. One, the memory, a place to store things that get declared inside multiply by two. We call it the local memory because it's just, local means like, you know, nearby. It's just stuff that's going to be available while we're running the code of multiply by two, not available out here. And anything which we announce or declare inside this function, any variables, you got it, stored in here, not in here. All right. So into this function we go, and what is the first thing that we're going to do inside of here? Ethan, what is the first thing we're going to do inside?
Declare the const result.
Ethan's almost right. That's the second thing we're going to do. But Ethan, whenever we run code in a function, the first thing we always handle, Ethan, is what? Before we hit the body of the function, we handle... We've got some stuff we're sort of inserting into the function. That's going to show up inside the local memory, and that is?
So input number.
Excellent. It's going to be set to what?
Three.
He's spot on. To num, which evaluated to three. There it is. Label, value. No different to out here. But these ones have special names. What's this one known as, people?
Parameter.
And this one here, folk?
Argument.
Exactly. So the placeholder... input number that's going to receive when the function ends up being run, an actual input, an actual value, actual number, that number that gets passed in is known as our argument. The placeholder that awaits it is known as our parameter. They are fundamentally different. I mean, they're, you know, two sides of the same coin, but they are fundamentally different things. One is the label, one is the thing stored in that label. Okay, then we hit result and assign it. Ethan, what is result going to be stored, what's going to have it stored in it?
Input number times two.
Which is going to be?
Six.
3 by 2 is going to be 6. Excellent. Thank you to Ethan. And then the final line, people, is an interesting one. We've got, Dan, return. Actually, hold on, Dan. I've asked you lots of times. So I'm going to mix it up. I'm going to turn to, Jason. Jason, what is this final line saying here?
It's saying that locate the block of memory that is bound to the label result.
Good.
And ship it out.
Yeah,
I like that.
I actually really like that. It says, go look up. What does this word result mean? JavaScript doesn't know automatically. So it goes hunting for it in our local memory, finds it's the number 6, and then takes that number and ships it, returns it, shoots it out. What's literally going to happen, people, is that the call to the running of the invocation, they all mean the same thing, of multiply by 2 with the input of 3, is going to evaluate 2. That means it's going to literally turn into the value, the thing. People, value is this, the anything that's stored. Not the label, which we fancily call the identifier. It's the thing stored, it's a value. We're going to evaluate, that is to say, we're going to turn this command, a thing you can't store, into the result, value, and look at that, it's literally going to evaluate into the number 6. And then that output is equal to 6. And there it is, returned out and assigned to output. Now, the browser is a remarkable creation. It has so much more than just JavaScript in it. So let's just, you know, we'll use our white pen here for the JavaScript engine as part of the, in blue, the overall web browser. That's sort of say, I know it's, I can't draw the Firefox. There it is, JavaScript. It doesn't run in isolation. It has a ton of features in the web browser as well. What are the other features that the web browser has? Adam, can you think of some other features the web browser has that JavaScript does not have?
Like DevTools?
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. Honestly, yeah, DevTools. Let's put it in. DevTools. Console. Yeah, absolutely. What other things, Matt?
WebSockets?
Yeah, sure. Sockets. What other things? There's some really key, two really key ones. Dan, you got one? Can JavaScript speak to the internet? Can it make network requests over the internet? No. JavaScript does not have the ability to speak to the internet. That is not a feature inside JavaScript. So, you know what? The browser does, though. The browser can make network requests. The browser is this incredible app that's full of all these. It's a composite of a JavaScript engine, this bit, plus a ton of non-JavaScript features, one of which is the ability for it to make network requests. What other thing does JavaScript definitely not have?
Rendering.
Yeah, rendering. Exactly. It has an. Is that in JavaScript? No. That's in the web browser, our HTML DOM. That is our model, our simplified version of what's on the page. Yeah, my position. That's our simplified version of what's on the page so that we can interact with it. So we can add stuff to that page. You know, document object model, it's a model, a simplified version of, in an object style format, of what's on the document, which is the visual of the page. Yeah. All these features, we cannot code for directly. They're written in whatever the browser's written in, C++ or whatever other, you know, languages the browser's written in. Do we write for these directly? But people, we do have a programming language that lets us use these features. And that programming language is JavaScript. But we're not actually going to find any of these features in JavaScript. So how do we interact with them? How do we interface with them? In JavaScript, we get a bunch of what I call facade functions, and it's not catching on. I'll be clear, this phrase is not catching on. A bunch of what's called, I call facade functions, they are functions that look like they're JavaScript, but are actually fronts, facades for web browser features. And you know what? One of those web browser features, believe it or not, JavaScript doesn't even have the feature of a timer. That's in the web browser too. And we get labels for each of these features that, let's hope, are perfectly aligned to the name. Oh, That would be very nice, right? If they were perfectly aligned to the name. Instead, Kayla, what do you think our label for timer would be?
Timer.
Oh, that makes sense. That would be a perfect name. But in reality, what label do we get in JavaScript in order to start a timer to delay a function, Kayla?
Set timeout.
Set timeout. That's it. Set timeout is not doing anything of interest in JavaScript. Instead, it's a label for the timer built into the web browser.